In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, how does using an RCD affect my earth fault loop impedance? Just before we explain the answer to this question, please be aware that this video is one of a series that we've made on the subject of electrical design, made in association with BG Electrical, part of the Luceco Group. They can be viewed individually, or you can click the link in the description below to view them as part of a free online training package to help you with your CPD, and you'll receive a certificate to prove you've completed the course. Why are we asking this question? Well, throughout this design process, we've protected our circuit by using an MCB and based all our calculations around that. But does our circuit need RCD protection? And if so, how does that affect all of our carefully crafted calculations, particularly when it comes to the earth fault loop impedance of our circuit? The last few amendments and additions of the wiring regs have increased the stringency of requirements for circuits to be protected by an RCD, and it's becoming increasingly common for the circuit to be protected by an individual RCBO to cut down the impacts of permissible leakage currents. While the gold standard for RCD protection is individual RCBOs, split load boards can still be made compliant, by the way. I've made a video elsewhere on our channel explaining how to do it if you're curious. But what specific regulations might affect our electric boiler circuit and make it require RCD protection? Well, there may be a tendency to think that this 9 kilowatt Fusion Comet electric boiler from the electric heating company would require an RCD because it's heating water, and of course we get a bit jittery around areas where water and electricity mix. But actually, there's no requirement to use one just because it's an electric boiler. We may feel inclined to do so because if we supply an electric shower in a bathroom, there is very clear direction to protect that with an RCD. We find that in part 7 on special locations, and specifically chapter 701, which is all about bathrooms and shower rooms, and contains regulation 701.411.3.3. Additional protection by RCDs. It reads, additional protection by the use of one or more RCDs having the characteristics specified in regulation 415.1.1 shall be provided for low voltage circuits. 1. Serving the location, so this would of course include an electric shower, but also 2. Passing through zones 1 and or 2, not serving the location. So there is a fringe but unlikely case where a boiler could be sited in the bathroom, but also where the cable feeding it could pass through zone 1 or 2 of a bathroom, and then it would require an RCD to protect it. But we're not doing that with our boiler. Another reason it may require RCD protection is the way that the cable supplying it is installed. This is highlighted for us in regulation 522.6.202. A cable installed in a wall or partition at a depth of less than 50mm from a surface of the wall or partition shall 1. Be installed in a zone within 150mm from the top of the wall or partition, or within 150mm of an angle formed by two adjoining walls or partitions, where the cable is connected to a point, accessory or switch gear on any surface of the wall or partition. The cable may be installed in a zone either horizontally or vertically to the point, accessory or switch gear, where the location of the accessory, point or switch gear can be determined from the reverse side. A zone formed on one side of a wall of 100mm thickness or less, or partition of 100mm thickness or less, extends to the reverse side. Or 2. Comply with regulation 522.6.204. So let's pick that apart. If our twin and CPC cable is buried in a wall, but not deeper than 50mm, we have to comply with either indent 1 or indent 2 of this regulation. This is because if a cable is buried in a wall, there is a chance that it could be drilled into or nailed into by someone who doesn't know what they're doing, or sometimes by someone who does know what they're doing. So we need to protect this person from themselves and the electricity in the cable by either of these indents. If we opt for indent 2, it directs us over the page in the regs to a list of options for preventing the nail or screw from piercing the cable. This includes things like using armoured cable, earth steel containment, and some other options. These options are a bit extreme, especially in domestic environments, and the increased cost of installing them is pretty prohibitive. So going back to the first reg, indent 1 is the easiest option. We need to keep our cables within the zones mentioned here, and again we've covered that information elsewhere so we won't repeat it here, but there's a little bit of further information after indent 2 where it says, where indent 1 but not indent 2 applies, the cable shall be provided with additional protection by means of an RCD having the characteristics specified in regulation 415.1.1. So if our PVC insulated twin and CPC cable is buried less than 50mm deep in the wall and doesn't have any extra mechanical protection as stated earlier, we need to provide additional protection in the form of an RCD. This is in place so that if someone accidentally drills or nails into a cable, the RCD will protect them if they receive a shock from that cable to earth. The same information applies in the following regulation for cables buried at any depth in a wall made of metallic parts, if it doesn't have extra mechanical protection. Moving to the regulation specified there, 415.1.1, we read, the use of RCDs with a rated residual operating current not exceeding 30 milliamps is recognised in AC systems as additional protection in the event of failure of the provision for basic protection and or the provision for fault protection or carelessness by users. So we'd need to use an RCD to protect our cable if it's buried in the wall. If you remember way back in part one of this training module, we stated that this cable would be surface mounted or clip direct along its entire length and isn't buried in a wall. So it doesn't require RCD protection. This was a very deliberate choice that I made so that I could explain clearly how to do simple circuit design and demonstrate the use of MCB protection. Because if we do use an RCD for additional protection, it can change some of our values along the way. How? Well, let's just toy with this design a little bit and say that it does need an RCD to protect it. What's the impact of that? The main one is that it will massively change our maximum allowed earth fault loop impedance. Do you remember in the previous couple of videos we looked at how quickly the circuit would need to trip in the event of an earth fault of negligible impedance, or what we can think of as kind of very, very low resistance? The speed of trip is determined by the amount of current flowing through the breaker, which in turn is determined by the impedance or opposition to current flow in the circuit when the fault occurs. Well, now we've changed the characteristics of that protective device and made it much more sensitive to fault current, meaning that it only takes a tiny amount of current to make the device trip in the event of an earth fault, namely just 30 milliamps or 30 thousandths of an amp flowing to earth either by the live conductors touching the protective conductor or by it passing through a human to earth. Because it only takes a tiny amount of fault current to make the device operate very quickly, this means that the impedance of the circuit when the fault occurs can be absolutely huge. This is confirmed for us in Regulation 411.4.204, which states, where an RCD is used to satisfy the requirements of Regulation 411.3.2.2, 411.3.2.3, or 411.3.2.4, these regs are to do with disconnection times of different circuits in different systems. The maximum values of earth fault loop impedance in table 41.5 may be applied for non-delayed RCDs to BSCN 61008-1 and BSCN 61009-1 for a nominal voltage UO of 230 volts. So although our RCD is being used for additional protection, not fault protection, it could be argued that we no longer have to refer to the tables we looked at previously to get our maximum permissible earth fault loop impedance, but we can use the simplified values in table 41.5. What does that tell us? Well, if we're using a 30 milliamp RCD, then the maximum earth fault loop impedance can be as high as 1,667 ohms. That's a huge figure and could theoretically lead to circuits that are kilometers long. Would that be okay? Well, the use of this table comes with a couple of caveats. First of all, the rest of the design has to work. So if we have a ridiculously long circuit, then the volt drop would probably be too high in the first place, and the load may not operate properly. Then there's a bit of regulation 411.4.204 that we handily skipped over earlier. It concludes by saying, in such cases, in other words, where we're using an RCD to achieve disconnection times, an overcurrent protective device shall provide protection against overload current and fault current in accordance with Chapter 43. So this is a bit of a nudge to remind us that there's more than one type of fault current that can affect our circuit. Using an RCD gives us confidence that our circuit will disconnect in the event of an earth fault where a live and protective conductor touch. But what about when two live conductors, like a line and a neutral, touch, the fault that we normally call a short circuit? An RCD by itself won't bat an eyelid when that happens. It won't even think about tripping. An RCBO will operate, but if we've made our circuit way too long in order to take advantage of that mad 1,667 ohm maximum earth fault loop impedance, the short circuit current may not be high enough to disconnect the circuit quickly, and the cable could overheat and start a fire. Pretty much the opposite of what we're aiming for with our installations. So how do we make sure that our circuits stay safe for all types of fault if we end up using an RCD for additional protection? Well, the best way is to keep in mind that the RCD in most cases is there for just that, additional protection. If you design the circuit using the process we've outlined in this series of 9 videos now, first of all doing all the calculations using an MCB as a protective device, then swapping it out at the end for the equivalent RCBO, then it should still meet all the other requirements for overload, short circuit, and earth fault protection. If you do want to dive straight in and use the RCD for earth fault protection, then you can use the same principles that we used in a previous video to calculate the earth fault loop impedance, but instead apply it to the total impedance of the line and neutral conductors instead. This will verify that the short circuit fault current will operate the protective device and disconnect the faulty circuit within the required times. This is usually something that we'd do for a TT system where we'd expect quite high earth fault loop impedances, but that's a whole future training package in itself. So there we go, that's some reasons why we may need to protect our circuit with an RCD and how that will affect our circuit design. But you may be wondering, should this circuit be protected by an AFDD? Well, to find out more about that, check out this video right here or click the link in the description below to watch it as part of our free online training package to help you with your CPD, and you'll receive a certificate as well. All that remains in this video is to say thank you very much for watching.